Good afternoon, everybody. You are about to watch Deeper Life Bible Church program, the Moment of Transformation. Today, by the grace of the Lord, we shall listen to our pastor, General Superintendent, Pastor W.F. Kumoye. You are going to be blessed. It is my wish that you call your family to come and listen to you as our pastor is blessing you with his holiness message. Be blessed.
What he said, amen. We're looking at Joel chapter 2 verse 23. Joel chapter 2 verse 23. Be glad then, ye children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord your God. For he has given you the former rain moderately, and he will cause to come down for you the rain, the former rain, and the latter rain in the first month. It'll cause to come down the former rain and the latter rain. And it says in the first month, when that latter rain comes, what's the implication? What's the spiritual outpouring that the Lord is talking about? Look at verse 28. And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. That's the latter rain. When he talks about the latter rain, he's talking about the outpouring of the Spirit of God. And then it says, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions. And also upon the servants and upon the handmaids in those days will I pour out my spirit. That pouring out, outpouring, that's the coming of the latter rain. As the rain pours down, the Spirit of God is poured down upon his saved, sanctified people. We're looking at James chapter 5 verse 7. James 5 verse 7. Be patient therefore, brethren, unto the coming of the Lord. Behold, the husbandman waiteth for the precious fruit of the earth, and as long patience for it, until he receive what? The early and the latter rain. That is the Spirit of God coming upon the people of God to perfect and to mature the fruit of the harvest. We're talking about the latter rain in latter days. I'm dividing the message to three parts. Number one, the promise of the latter rain. The promise is giving us a promise, and there's a promise of the latter rain. But understand, every time we're talking about the latter rain, we're talking about the Spirit of God, the outpouring of that Spirit to come upon the people of God, refreshing us, renewing us, revitalizing us, and doing what the Spirit of God is sent to do in the individual believer, in the ministers of the gospel, as well as in the membership of the church. The promise of the latter rain. Number two, our preparation for the latter rain. Our preparation for the latter rain. Number three, the purpose of the latter rain. Number one is the promise of the latter rain. See the promise the Lord has given us concerning the outpouring of the Spirit. We're back to Joel again. In Joel chapter 2, verse 23, be glad then, ye children of Zion. Rejoice in the Lord your God, for he has given you the former rain moderately. He said, the Spirit of God has been poured out, but in a moderate way. You look at the land of Israel before the day of Pentecost. They had the Spirit too. Moses had the Spirit of God. Joshua had the Spirit of God. Micah had the Spirit of God. Micaiah has the Spirit of God. David had the Spirit of God, because when he was anointed, the Spirit of God came upon him. But they had the Spirit of God moderately. That was the former rain. But now it says in that verse, verse 23, and he will cause to come down for you the rain, the former rain, and the latter rain in the first month. That means that whatever the people had gotten before, they were still to get more. We'll get more of the Spirit of God. And when that Spirit comes, look at what it will do. Verse 24, and the floors shall be full of wheat. That means there'll be harvesting. And the wheat, that's if you go back to, or if you go forward to the parables of the Lord Jesus Christ, the tares are the children of the world, and the wheat, that those are the children of God. And when the Spirit of God is poured out, there will be multiplication of converts in Jesus' name. It says in verse 25, and I will restore unto you the years that the locusts have eaten, and the canker worm, and the caterpillar, and the palmer worm, my great army which I sent among you, I will restore. When the latter rain comes, that is, when the outpouring of the Spirit comes upon us, there will be also the restoration of everything that we have lost. Think about whatever it is you had before that you have lost, your prayer life and the Spirit of God coming upon you and everything that you have lost. It says, if that Spirit will come again, if there will be the outpouring of that rain once again, the latter in the Holy Spirit upon the people of God, there will be restoration. I said there will be restoration. And then in verse 26, and you shall eat in plenty. There will be provision too, and be satisfied. And praise the name of the Lord your God, he that has dealt wondrously with you, and my people shall never be ashamed. With the coming of the latter rain, with the coming of the Spirit of God being poured upon us, all the shame, all the reproach, everything will be taken away. And ye shall know that I am in the midst of Israel, and that I am the Lord your God, and none else, and my people shall never be ashamed. Then in verse 28, and it shall come to pass, that means it will so happen afterward, that I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions. It says the coming of the Holy Ghost, or the outpouring of the Spirit of God, will bring something, will bring dreams to the old and visions to the young. Do you know sometimes when people are called on to do something, they say, I'm too young, I don't think I can fit in. I don't think I have the experience. I don't think I have the learning. I don't think I have the authority to be able to do that. I'm too young. Then you call the other people and they say, I'm too old at this time now. You know, the old, they give excuse, I'm too old. And the young, they give excuse, I'm too young. Who then is going to do the work? Because you're either old or young, either young or old. And when you give excuse, I'm too young, I don't have experience, I cannot do it. What if David said, I'm too young, I cannot confront Goliath? And then Saul said, I'm too old, I cannot confront Goliath. Who is going to do it? That's why the Lord said, I'll bring the latter in. I'll pour my Spirit upon all flesh. And when I pour my Spirit upon all flesh, here is what will happen. The people that are old, they will have dreams to dream. When you think about it, what most things forward is the people that dream, the people that see something we don't see. And it's not dreaming the night, they dream during the day. And they said, because we're dreamers, we're unstoppable, we've got to do something. And then the people also, the young people, they begin to see visions. And without, where there's no vision, the people perish. And you can tell there are some people, they don't have any vision at all. And that's why we're not covering the land that we ought to cover. That same promise of the latter rain we're told now in Acts of the Apostles. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 2. We're looking at it from verse 17. Acts chapter 2, back up to verse 16. But this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. What did the prophet Joel speak about? He spoke about the latter rain. And now on the day of Pentecost, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, it says they were all sitting in one place. And the Spirit of God came upon them, each of them, like cloven tongues of fire. And the interpretation of Peter to all the people observing is that this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. It shall come to pass in the last days. Latter rain for the last days. The outpouring of the Spirit of God in the last days. It shall come to pass in the last days, says God, I will pour out of my Spirit upon deeper life, upon the Pentecostals, upon all flesh. Do you know that not all Christians will be in our local church? Some of the Christians will be in other churches. Not all the Christians will be in the Methodist church. Not all of them will be in the Baptist church. And not all of them will be in the Catholic church either. And God said, I'll pour out my spirit upon all flesh. In the early days of this Pentecostal outpouring, 1906, Azusa Street, and then coming to 1937, coming to 1945, when David Duplessis, actually what had happened is that David Duplessis was a white South African, and Smith Wigglesworth went to South Africa. And this early morning, Smith Wigglesworth just went into Duplessis' office, and without even saying good morning, I just laid hands on him and stood him to the wall, and then prophesied upon him that God will take him to different places, and he will go to various churches, and through him there'll be this outpouring upon all flesh. Now, the church that David Duplessis belonged to, they were classical Pentecostal people. You know, people like Assemblies of God, those are the people we refer to as classical Pentecostal. And the First Choir, those are the people we refer to as classical Pentecostal. And the apostolic faith that came out of Junji Lake in South Africa, classical Pentecostal. And that God was going to use David Duplessis. He was going to go to all these places and bring the experience of being baptized in the Holy Ghost. And eventually, when he started, his own church misunderstood. That's what I'm saying. That sometimes tradition can pull the string, and the revelation of God will miss that out. But David Duplessis continued, and God took him to various places. He talked about salvation. I've listened to him directly myself, a number of messages that David Duplessis preached, and he talked about being filled with the Holy Ghost. And many people were being filled with the Holy Ghost. Eventually, before he died, the classical church that disagreed with him, they brought him back again. They said, now we understand. What if they had understood the very beginning when God started using that man? And all the pressure, all the persecution, all the slander that came would not have come. But later, they understood. I pray we will understand. The plan of God is not to only take our little church here to heaven. I think if in my Father's house are many mansions, if it were not so, I would have told you. If only Deeper Life will get to heaven, I think heaven will be so scanty. And the people you see in heaven will be all the people you are familiar with. But thank God, the people that are going to get to heaven, I think they are larger than this. I said they are larger than this. And why don't you then open up yourself and release yourself to minister to the rest of the body? Because it says, I'll pour my spirit upon all flesh. And then it says in that verse 17, and it says, your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. And your young men shall do what? See visions. And your old men shall dream dreams. And on my servants and on my handmaids will I will pour out in those days of my spirit, and they shall prophesy. That's the latter end right there, and the Lord has given us the promise. Look at verse 38 and verse 39. In verse 38, then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. For the promise is unto you and to your children. Wait a minute, Peter. The promise is unto you, those are Jews, and to your children. Who are those? Jews. Unto you, the Jews, because what are these? The Jews. And then to your children, the children of the Jews will be Jews. And then he said, and to them. Sometimes God reveals something through you. And when that revelation comes through you, and God says, I used you to say that, I'm going to use you to fulfill that same thing. Then you say, not so, Lord. That's what he said. To them that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. Those far off people are Gentiles. Those are not Jews, Peter. And already you prophesied it, you said it, that in this day of the Holy Ghost, he will use you to even fill those people that are far off with the Holy Ghost. And when the Lord said, because I used you to prophesy that now, get up and do it, he said, not so, Lord. Let's watch. Sometimes we need to even hear the messages we ourselves preach and see what the Lord has sent through, said through you. And when the Lord has said it through you and it's now time to fulfill it and carry it out, rise up and do it, and don't let tradition bind you or make you to stay behind. You'll do it in Jesus' name. That's the promise that the Lord has given, and we're going to receive that promise. He's going to pour his spirit upon us in Jesus' name. Point number two, our preparation for the latter rain. Our preparation for the latter rain. We need to do some preparation. And the Lord makes it very clear what kind of preparation we need to make. We're looking at Job chapter 29. Job chapter 29, and we're looking at verse 23. Job 29, verse 23. They waited for me as for the rain. They opened their mouth wide as for the latter rain. They waited for me as for the rain. That means then, as we're expecting the latter rain, how many are expecting today? We're expecting. It says, we'll open our mouth wide for the latter rain. For the latter rain, that's our preparation. The promise is given, and we need to wait. You'll find that word there, that verse 29, before we go to another verse. And they waited for me. They waited for me. There is a waiting. That's the preparation for the Holy Ghost. We're looking at Luke chapter 24. Luke chapter 24, verse 49. Luke 24, verse 49. And behold, I sent the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry ye. To tarry is to wait. Tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until ye be endued with power from on high. He wants to pour out the rain, the latter rain. He wants to pour out his spirit. And he says, wait, tarry. In Acts of the Apostles, chapter 1, verse 4. Acts chapter 1, verse 4. It tells us, and being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait. That's the word. Waiting for the latter rain. Asking for the latter rain. Praying for the latter rain. Seeking the face of the Lord for the latter rain. Until he comes and he pours that rain upon us. But wait for the promise of the Father, which saith he, ye have heard of me. For John truly baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. In our preparation, we're waiting. And as we're waiting, what are we doing? We're examining ourselves. We're making ourselves ready, suitable to have this outpouring, this rain coming from heaven. In 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 1. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, we're looking at verse 1. Having therefore these promises, dearly beloved. You remember the promise we're talking about? The promise of the latter rain. The promise of the outpouring of the Holy Ghost upon the saved and sanctified believers, disciples. Waiting for this power that he had promised, the endowment of power from on high. And now he says, as we are waiting for the fulfillment of that promise, we need something to be done in our hearts, in our lives. And we need to prepare ourselves for that outpouring. This is what he said, having therefore these promises, dearly beloved. For it says, let us do what? Cleanse.